All right, so good to see everyone this morning. I've not said this in a while, but I feel like I should. Welcome to Christ Fellowship Church. We as Christ Fellowship Church exist to be a community of Jesus disciples and to make disciples of all nations, even when we are meeting over Zoom. So thank you for being here. Thank you for coming together to worship the King. And I just want to start by acknowledging the fact that as we come here this morning, no matter if you are a member of Christ Fellowship Church or you're a visitor, whether you are a firm believer or you are a seeker or you're a skeptic, you are here in this room this morning because of the work of Christ, because the Spirit has brought you here in some way, shape, or form, some capacity. And so we are here purely by the grace of God and not our own doing. And so as we begin this church service, what I want to start with recognizing is that this is not about us. It's about lifting up praises to the King. And that's why we start with a reading of adoration and a prayer of adoration. The whole focus is to begin the service and to take the focus away from us and what's on our mind, from the busyness of the weeks, and just reorient our minds and our hearts towards God. So we are going to begin today with a reading of adoration and a prayer of adoration. And this comes from Psalm chapter 97. So if you've got your e-bulletin with you, it's printed there. Or if you've got your Bibles, you can turn to Psalm 97. But just take this moment to quiet your mind, quiet your heart, reflect on the good news of who God is, and reflect on the fact that Psalm 97 tells us who this God is that we are here today to worship. This is Psalm 97, taken from the NIV. The Lord reigns. Let the earth be glad. Let the distant shores rejoice. Clouds and thick darkness surround him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. Fire goes before him and consumes his foes on every side. His lightning lights up the world. The earth sees and trembles. The mountains melt like wax before the Lord of all the earth. The heavens proclaim his righteousness, and all people see his glory. All who worship images are put to shame, those who boast in idols. Worship him, all you gods. Zion hears and rejoices, and the villages of Judah are glad because of your judgments, Lord. For you, Lord, are the most high over all the earth. You are exalted far above all gods. Let those who love the Lord hate evil, for he guards the lives of his faithful ones and delivers them from the hand of the wicked. Light shines on the righteous and joy on the upright in heart. Rejoice in the Lord, you who are righteous, and praise his holy name. Please join me in prayer to our glorious God. Lord, we come before you and we recognize that today's worship service is a worship service of you. It's about you, Lord. We are here because of you and the work that you have done and are doing in our lives, Lord. Help us to see that it's your journey. It's your plans and purposes that are being fulfilled. And Lord, we are simply brought into that. We give you praise and we just lift you up as the God before whom mountains melt. Lord, as we climb and we work and we summit to the top, Lord, mountains melt before you because you are the good, glorious creator of all things. Lord, we just give you the praise that you deserve today. Prepare our hearts for this time of worship and shepherd us closer to you. In the name of Father, Son, and Spirit, we pray this in the name of God. Amen. And now we are going to respond to the goodness of God and this good news with two worship songs led by Scott and our worship team.
Christ is my reward and all my life. song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear, for I am a child.
Amen. Well, in light of this good news, so we've gone to God and we've praised him, we've given him glory for his grandeur and his splendor, but one of the aspects of being believers is that as we approach the throne, we see that we are not God, that we are not fit to come into the presence of God, and therefore we need to be cleansed. And so that is why we engage in this time of a confession of sin. Really, confession is almost a matter of justice. It's a matter of just addressing what is true and not hiding it, not acting as if we are better or brighter than we want to be, but just being honest with God about who we are and who we've been and what we've done. So now look at your e-bulletin and please join me, confess with me this confession of sin as we go before God, and then we'll spend some time in individual silent confession. Lord God, we confess that you've made us to be a people who give glory and honor to you, and instead we've sought to glorify ourselves. You have made us to be charitable, and we've been selfish. You've made us to be just, and we've been unjust. We've done what we shouldn't do, and we've refused to do what we should have. Lord God, show us the depths of our sinfulness so we can experience the heights of your forgiveness. Show us the bitterness of our neediness so we can experience the freedom of your salvation. Lord God, in your mercy, forgive us of our sins. Amen. And now let's take just a minute in silent, personal, prayerful confession and reflection before God. Now, church, the good news of the gospel message is that we do not stay here. We do not stay in our sinfulness and our brokenness and our neediness, but instead we are lifted up by God. We are forgiven and we are set free. And so to highlight that good news, we now turn to Lindsay Moll, our elder on duty, who will impart to us our assurance of pardon.
Good morning, Christ Fellowship Church. Please join me now as we meditate together on the assurance of our pardon and pray to our Father in thanksgiving. Reading from Romans chapter 8, verses 33 through 39. Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come before you today in sweet togetherness like never before, but like we always do, Father. We are in awe of your power and grace, thinking on what you've done for us and our response in humble gratitude for your incredible sacrifice, overcoming the impossible so that we may have the honor of fellowship with you. Please continue to refine our faith and thank you for fully supplying for our every need according to your riches and glory. In Jesus' precious name, we pray to you, Father. Amen.
Would you please join me in singing the doxology? Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Please join me in prayer. Father God, we come before you as this great God who created the world and is mighty and glorious, God, but not only creates, but redeems and restores and renews, Lord, the God that takes us broken, sinful, needy people and brings us in back into your presence, Lord, renews us with the blood of Christ, gives us a new life, and wraps us into your very triune nature, Lord. What an unbelievable gift, Lord, not because we deserve it, but purely out of your grace and out of your love and out of your justice, Father God. God, just tune our hearts to you, that we may not run, that we may not flee, but that we may come to you. Lord, use us as living sacrifices for you to not only be disciples, but to make disciples, Lord. And as we get ready to enter into your word and to hear what you have to say to us and how you want to challenge us and grow your people and use your people, tune our hearts to you and use your spirit to bring us into your presence, Lord. Teach us what you want to show us during this time. We pray this in the name of your Son, who allows us to come to you in prayer. Amen. Now, we are going to sing one more song before we get into the reading of the word. Parents, this is the time where if you've got kiddos and you want to set them up with a craft, go ahead and step away, get them ready to go. Otherwise, if you are anyone else in this Zoom session, let us come together and we're going to have one more song, which will be Blessed Be Your Name.
Blessed be your name.
Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And so we now come to the Word of God and see what it has to tell us today. And Chris Barlow will be doing our reading today from Acts chapter 2. So if you've got your Bibles with you, Bible app on your phone or a website, turn to that now. And Chris Barlow will lead us in the reading of God's Word.
Good morning, Christ Fellowship. I'll be reading from Acts 2 today, 1 through 13 and 42 to 47. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Are all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Philia, Egypt, and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They have had too much wine." Verse 42. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts, broke bread in their homes, and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning again, church. Good to be with you and worshiping with you as always. If you've got your Bibles with you, you should already have them turned to Acts 2, but I'm going to give you one other chance to get Acts 2 pulled up on the Bible app or on a website or in your Bible. But I want to start today by talking about a word that maybe for some of you is familiar and others is not, and that is the word liturgy. And when I say the word liturgy, our minds probably all go in a million different directions, right? Some of you may not know what that means. Some of you may think of kind of Catholic churches and Lutheran churches and Anglican churches. You may think of dry, repetitive readings. You may think of just a boring atmosphere, kind of very traditional and outdated. But I want to blow that view up. I want to expand your understanding of this word liturgy. I don't want you to be fearful of this word. I don't want it to be a word that when I say, "Hey, I'd like to look at some new liturgies for CFC," that you immediately cringe and get nervous. Because really what the word liturgy is referring to is habits and rhythms and routines that are a part of our life. So for example, at CFC, every single Sunday when we were meeting in the physical building, we had the liturgy of offering, right? We would do it every single week, and that liturgy was a sign of thankfulness. I personally have a liturgy. I have a liturgy of morning coffee where I get up early and I brew a cup of coffee and I get in the Word, and that is a liturgy of devotion to God, a liturgy of preparing my heart for the day. So yes, every church has liturgies, and our personal lives have liturgies as well. And so maybe that's the first time you've heard that, and I want you to think, what are my personal liturgies? What are my daily and weekly liturgies? And even beyond that, especially in this time of COVID-19, where your liturgies and your rhythms and your Google or Apple calendar has been dismantled, what are your current liturgies? What has remained? And that matters. That tells you something about your heart.
In the book Desiring the Kingdom by James K.A. Smith, which is a fantastic book, but I highly recommend it, James K.A. Smith looks at liturgies. He looks at how liturgies affect us, inform us, and change us. And in the introduction to his book, he lays out his main thesis, and he says this. I'm going to read it. The core claim of this book is that liturgies, and again, liturgies being routines, habits, ongoing regular actions, liturgies shape our identities by forming our most fundamental desires and our most basic attunement to the world. In other words, he goes on to say, liturgies make us certain kinds of people, and what defines us is what we love. What James K. Smith is arguing in this book is that the liturgies of our life shape who we are and who we become and what we love. So it matters, these rhythms that we enter into. And we are now entering into a brand new series. We finished discipleship in Mark, and this series will get at some of what James K. Smith is talking about. I want us to look at liturgies. And most importantly, I want us to ask the question, what are you devoted to? Our sermon series is called Devoted, and it comes from Acts chapter 2. It primarily comes from Acts chapter 2, verse 42, and it asks the question, what are you devoted to? And what are the liturgies of your life? You see, in Acts chapter 2, we have finished up Mark. You know, Jesus has died, he's risen again. We move into Acts, and Jesus ascends to the right hand of the Father. And in Acts chapter 2, the disciples enter into kind of new liturgies apart from Jesus, new liturgies that grow them as disciples, even when Jesus isn't there. And so what I want to ask is, what are these disciples devoted to, and what does that mean for us today? And our main point for today is this. Disciples of Jesus Christ are continually devoted to the rhythms of knowing God. Or another way to say it is, disciples are continually devoted to the liturgies of knowing God. And we'll look at some of those liturgies today. We'll look at four primary liturgies. But as we move through the text today, what we're going to see is three things. Why were the disciples devoted? How were the disciples devoted? And then what was the outcome of the disciples' devotion? I'm really, really looking forward to the sermon series. It's meant a lot for me, and hopefully it'll mean a lot for you. So let's begin in that primary verse that we're looking at for the next 5 to 6 weeks, Acts chapter 2, verse 42. And let's ask the question of, why were the disciples devoted? And verse 42 says, they, meaning the disciples, devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Now, we're going to look at those four liturgies that they devoted themselves to, but first we have to ask the question, why? Why did they take the time to devote themselves to these four liturgies? Why are they devoted to anything at all? And the answer is God. The simple, beautiful, powerful answer is God. That's why they're devoted. In the Gospel of Mark, which we just finished, the disciples have walked with God and talked with God and experienced God and seen the miracles and the power of God. But as we saw earlier in Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 13, they're no longer just seeing God from a distance. They are filled with the presence of God. God's Spirit is now inside of them. And they're thinking, I want more. I've experienced God. I've encountered God. I'm filled with God, and I want more. I want to know God. I want to worship God. I want to love God. I want to learn more about God. I want to be with God. I want more of God. And the first question that we have to ask, church, is that you? Have you had a personal encounter with God and now you're saying, I want more? Is that you? And that question's important because that really serves as the prerequisite for today's sermon. It serves as the prerequisite for the next 4, 5, 6 weeks of this sermon series. And I mean this in all sincerity. If you look at Acts chapter 2, and this community of the disciples, and your heart doesn't flutter, if you don't read this and long for the community that they have, I would encourage you, stop watching this video and pray. Go to God and say, Lord, give me a longing for this picture of the kingdom. Help me to desire this community that you've laid before me. Make this a longing of my heart. If you're thinking to yourself, yeah, I've had a personal kind of encounter with God, but there's no desire in your heart whatsoever to know him or to be with him or to spend time with him, then stop and pray. Go to God and say, Lord, give me a longing for you. Help me to desire you more, because only the Spirit can give you that heart. Submit yourself to God and say, Lord, give me more of a rich, deep desire for you. You'll need that as we work through this series. But to get back to the disciples and this question of why, because the disciples were devoted to God through a true, rich, personal experience with God, they then turned around and devoted themselves to four liturgies: apostles' teaching, fellowship, breaking of bread, and prayer. We're kind of going to lead into the how question now. We've looked at the why, but now that we know why the disciples were devoted to these four liturgies, let's ask the question of how. How were the disciples devoted? And this is where I want to spend most of our time today. And again, when we answer that how question, the most obvious thing that we see is how were they devoted? Well, they devoted themselves to four things. The apostles' teaching, which for us today would be God's word, the apostles' teaching, and so much more. They devoted themselves to fellowship, which is a unified community of believers all seeking the same goal of being disciples. They devoted themselves to breaking bread, which means both kind of coming together and sharing meals in homes, but also coming together in the temple courts and literally breaking bread, entering into the Lord's Supper. And finally, they entered into prayer, conversation with God. Those are the four primary liturgies that the disciples have devoted themselves to. And you may be kind of looking to verse 43 and 44 and 45 and saying, but wait, no, there's other things that they did. There's other things they devoted themselves to. It says there were these signs and wonders, and they were kind of meeting together, and they were sharing things in common, and they sold things, and they took that money to help the poor. Absolutely. But what I would argue is that those things are primarily rooted in these four liturgies. Those are outcomes and extensions of these four liturgies. And it might be frustrating to you. It might seem like a tease, and if so, then that's great. But we're not going to primarily dig into those four liturgies today. We're going to spend the next 4 weeks looking at each one of them in turn, why they matter, how we apply them to our lives, in more specifics. But today, what I want to do is talk more big picture, more broadly. I want to look at these four pieces of liturgy and say, what did it look like? What do we see about these four pieces of liturgy? Back to the how question. And the first thing that I want to say is that of these four pieces of liturgy, what we see is that they're surprisingly simple. These are surprisingly simple. These are things that you can do pretty much every day. You can do pretty much every week. They are ordinary rhythms that you can apply to your life. If you have a Bible, if you have some Christian friends, if you belong to a church, then you can do all of these things. These four liturgies work with your family. They work with your job. They work with your hobbies and your friends. These four rhythms, they work for poor, rich, black, white, male, female. These four rhythms can be established when life is busy and hectic and crazy, or when you are in the middle of a stay-at-home order in a pandemic. These four rhythms can almost always be a part of your life, and they should be. They're simple, and yet they're also powerful. They're also very powerful. Pastor Tim Keller gives this illustration where, you know, he saw an acorn in a graveyard. You know, it had fallen to the ground. It had lodged itself within a crack of a tombstone, this little tiny acorn seed. And over time, as the rain came, and the sun beat down, that acorn started to grow. It started to put down roots. It started to become a tree. And as it grew and it grew and it grew, eventually it worked its way up through the crack of that tombstone and broke that tombstone in half. That little, simple, ordinary seed that was so insignificant eventually became this powerful, mighty tree that broke a tombstone in two. And that is what these liturgies can do for you and me. They're simple and they're ordinary, but if we stick with them, they have powerful results for the disciples of Jesus Christ, and we will get to that later. They're simple, but they're powerful. And the next thing that we see about how the disciples devoted themselves really comes from the word devoted here in the text. It comes from the Greek word for devoted. And when we look at this word devoted in the Greek, what it means in the Greek is constant attention. Or if we look at the NASB translation of scripture, which is more literal than the NIV and the ESV, it translates verse 42 this way. It says, they were continually devoting themselves. The NIV simply says, the disciples devoted themselves. NASB says, they were continually devoting themselves. The disciples did not miss an opportunity to engage in these liturgies. The disciples took these liturgies extremely seriously. In fact, if you think back to Good Friday, I know many of you fasted along with me. It was a great experience. But one of the benefits of fasting for those three meals during the day and replacing them with prayer and with Bible study is what you communicate is the reality of I need this just as much as I need a meal. In the same way that I never miss dinner because it's essential for me and it helps me grow, I do not miss getting in the Word and praying because it is essential for my growth. That's how seriously we should take this. In the kind of 3rd, 4th century, you had the rise of monks. And the whole issue for monks is they looked at the Christian sphere and said, people are taking this way too laxly. They're being way too lazy with their Christian faith. And we want to take it more seriously. So they would retreat. They would kind of live in these group homes with other monks. And they would set these rigid calendars. They would wake up multiple times a day, midnight, 3 a.m., 6 a.m., 9 p.m., pray, get in the Word, fellowship with other monks. I mean, they made these liturgies an essential part of their life because it was that important. So, church, do we take these liturgies that seriously? Are we making time for these things regularly? Are we making time for them at all? I really want scripture to challenge us in this sermon series. And that might make us uncomfortable, but it's for our benefit. And what I see in Acts chapter 2 is that if you're not making time for these four things, can you really call yourself a disciple? Honestly, if you're devoted to God and you love Him and you want more time for God, you'll find a way to make time for these four things. If you don't care to find time for these liturgies of knowing God, can you really call yourself a disciple? And the question is, if you're not devoting yourself to these four rhythms, then what are you devoting yourself to? Again, to go back to James K.A. Smith, what he says in this book that's so true is that all human beings are worshiping beings. We all are worshiping something. So if you're not worshiping God, if you're not praying and getting in the Word and breaking bread, then what are you doing? If someone were to follow you around for a month with a pad and a pen and a tape recorder and watch and observe everything that you did for a month, what would they say that you love? Would they say, oh, they love God, they love their church community, they're all in? Or would they say, no, I think they love sports. I think they love work. What'd they say about you? Because the final thing that I want to say in this section is that, again, when we look at the word devoted in the Greek, another way of understanding that word is that it means persevere. And the word persevere indicates that there's something to be persevering against, right? And what that means is that these are rhythms that you enter into even if you do not feel like it. I'm going to get into the Bible hopefully every day, even when I'm tired and I don't want to, because it's important. When I go to church, I'm going to fellowship with other believers before and after the service, even if I am deathly introverted, because it is good for me and helps me to grow. You can either eat broccoli because you know it's good for you and you don't like it, or you can eat broccoli because you love it. But either way, you need to eat broccoli because it is good for you. It helps you to grow big and strong. And the most beautiful aspect of liturgies like this is that you may start eating broccoli. You may start getting in the Word even when you don't want to, even when you don't like it. But over time, as you repeat that rhythm over and over, your heart can change to the point where you say, I need it. I want it. I love it. When I was in college and I started taking my faith seriously, getting in the Word was such a chore. You know, how many chapters do I have to read? When can I be done? Now I cannot wait to wake up in the morning, get a cup of coffee, and get in God's Word. And that, again, is why these four rhythms are so simple but so powerful. They're so powerful, and they are essential to your life with Christ. So are you making time? Don't let that question just slink by. Are you making time for these four rhythms? Now, the last thing I want to look at today is the response to this devotion. What do we see from the disciples as the outcome of their devotion to God and their devotion to these four rhythms? And it's surprising. Now, I'm going to look at the end of 46, verse 46 into 47. It says that they, being the disciples, broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God. So pause there. What we see, the first outcome, is that the disciples get what they want, right? At the beginning, we talked about how they had this incredible encounter with God, and what they wanted more than anything is more God. We want to enter into God. We want to experience God, and they get that here. They are drawn closer to God. They're joyful in Him. They're praising Him. And if we look at the other verses that we didn't do a deep dive into today, we see a sense that the disciples, they have meaning, they have joy, they have purpose, they have love, they have fellowship, they have hope. They have a sense of fulfillment and joy. Every single human being in this world wants the good life, but we disagree on what the good life is. Well, the disciples are living it. They are living the good life in Acts chapter 2. So the first outcome of their devotion to God and their pouring into these rhythms is that they're fulfilled. They get what they want. But secondly, and most shockingly, we see the outcome that comes in verse 47. It says that the disciples were praising God and enjoying the favor of all people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. That's incredible. Outsiders, non-believers, are looking in at this community of disciples, and they're saying, that's impressive. That's incredible what they have. I want that. In fact, I want that so much that I have to be a part of it. I want to know your God. I want to be saved. I want to be brought into this kingdom that you are a part of. I want a relationship with Jesus Christ. That's how powerful this community of disciples becomes. And as the passage correctly indicates, yes, the Lord is the one that changes hearts. Only the Spirit can draw people to God and bring them to salvation. But the truth and the beauty of God, the excellence of a life lived with God, is shown through us. It's shown through our lifestyle. It's shown through the way that we live together. And this has a key a purpose for us today in 2020. There's something that we have to see. This right here, this is how churches grow. This is how churches grow. Your neighbors, your friends, your family, seeing what you have in the body of Christ and saying, I want that. I desire that. Tell me more. The church does not primarily grow through business principles and business tactics. The church does not primarily go through having the newest, shiniest, quickest strategies. The church does not primarily grow through gimmicks. Look at Willow Creek Church. Willow Creek Church is one of the biggest churches in America. And Willow Creek Church were kind of one of the early pioneers of the seeker-friendly model of church. So they kind of said, okay, we're going to have a church that's got really nice coffee, gift shop, comfortable seats. We're going to have a worship band that just rocks. We're going to have a pastor that preaches the most simple messages that anyone can take in. And in doing this, their numbers shot through the roof. They became one of the biggest churches in America. But in 2007, they did an in-house study of their church. And what they found out is people aren't growing. People aren't growing as disciples. And not only are people not growing and being transformed in the way that we want, but even as people pour through the front door, people are pouring out the back door. Give it enough time and people say there's not enough meat here. Church, as I've said, I want this sermon series, I want scripture to challenge us. It should challenge us every single day. And I want to ask the question, is this CFC? Is this Christ Fellowship Church? Does Christ Fellowship Church look like Acts chapter 2? And what I mean by that is, do people look at Christ Fellowship Church and say, I want that. I want what they have. Their community, their lifestyle is desirable. I have to know the God that they worship. Is that our church? And one way of broaching that is to say, are we growing? Are we growing as disciples? Or are we growing numerically? And if we're not, well, then we may have our answer. But the problem here is that if we look at our church and we say, well, it's not this Acts 2 community, it's not that powerful, desirable group of people that brings people to salvation in Christ. The issue that we can run into is saying, well, that's Matt's fault. Matt should preach better sermons. No, that's Scott's fault. Scott's worship should be on par with Hillsong. No, it's an issue of programming. We need more programming in the church. No, we need more targeted Facebook ads and a better social media presence. Then we would truly grow. No. How do we primarily grow as people and as a body? By being devoted to Jesus Christ and devoting ourselves to these simple, ordinary, powerful rhythms. These four practices that we've talked about today, and we will expand over the coming weeks, these liturgies, they grow us, they grow our community, and they grow our church through the working of the Spirit. And why is that? Because they lead us into a deeper love and richness in Jesus Christ. Isn't that incredible? The more you enjoy Christ, the more that we enjoy Christ as a church community, the more that others will notice and see. It's not about being the wisest or the sharpest or having business principles or tactics. It's about being devoted to God. And when you are devoted to God, Christ becomes non-ignorable to other people. That is a win-win. That's the beauty of what we see in Acts chapter 2. Church, Jesus Christ has given his life for you. He has died in your place. He has set you free to love the triune God, and he wraps us up into his triune nature. He leads us into the good life of truth and beauty and excellence. So my goodness, can't we make time for him each day? Can't we make time for him each week? Can't we find time to get into his word and to pray and to fellowship and to break bread? If your heart is not in it, if you don't catch the vision, if you're not excited about what we're talking about and what's here in Acts chapter 2, pray. Go to God and pray that he would grab your heart. If your life is too busy to implement these liturgies, change something. Change something. If you don't know how to get started, just get started. Just begin. This matters, church. May we be challenged. May we be excited. May we love Jesus Christ so much that we cannot keep him to ourselves. Church, my prayer is that the Lord would increase our desire for God and give us hearts and minds that are utterly devoted to Him and being wrapped up in Him as much as we possibly can every day and every week. Let's pray. Lord, we just surrender to you. We thank you for this unbelievably beautiful picture that we see in Acts chapter 2 of the disciples just living together and loving you and wanting more of you and enjoying the favor of one another and of all people. Lord, it's a utopian picture. It's the beauty of your kingdom, God. It's a reflection of where we will ultimately be with you in your eternal kingdom. Lord, just praise and thank you to you. For your glory, for your goodness, for all that you're doing, Lord, stir our hearts up. Produce a revival in our hearts and our minds, Lord. Make us a people of joy and excitement. Make us a people of devotion to what matters, which is you, Lord. Draw us deeper into your presence, and may we bring others along for the ride. Lead us through this series, Lord. In your name, Jesus Christ, amen. Church, love you. Thank you for being with us today. And let's close with a couple more songs.
sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit.
What good news we have. What good news that we have already received or is available to us if we've not yet received it, that Christ has come as King, that God has broken into the darkness of our world, and he has made a way for us to come into his presence and to know him. So as we continue to seek to be disciples and to live into that reality and share that reality with others and just become more and more alive as Christ Fellowship Church, please receive this benediction. May the Lord till the soil of your heart and show you your need for him. May the Lord show you the goodness and the glory of being devoted to Christ the King. And may it manifest itself in renewed rhythms and liturgies which draw you closer and closer into the reality of our amazing triune God. We pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, through whom we are remade and made new creatures. Amen. Church, thank you so much for worshiping our amazing King today. I'm going to go ahead and stop the recording at this time. The service is over, but feel free to linger around for a little bit and say goodbye to everyone here. So thanks for being here today. And unmute.